in front of the Blessed Sacrament, in front of Jesus present in the Eucharist. The second question is, how is it possible that saints, many saints, lived on the Eucharist alone? No food, no water, wholly and solely on the Eucharist as their food. How can we truly believe that Jesus is present in the Eucharist? What evidence is there? Is there proof? There's a lot. I can't wait to talk about it. And this one was my favorite. How is it that MS Word, my Android, my kids' eye things all know that Jesus Christ is present in the Eucharist? And then the last question is, so if all these people and all these things believe in the true presence of Jesus in the Eucharist, how is it that so many Catholics, including myself at one point, didn't fully comprehend that truth? Because there's so much evidence that points to this truth. So the first question is, why do so many saints, or did they, fall prostrate in front of Jesus' presence in the Eucharist? And one of my favorite stories is St. Mother Teresa. Father Rocky was presiding at Mass with all of the Sisters of Charity. And the minute of consecration, when he raised the host, all of the Sisters of Charity dropped to their faces in reverence for Jesus' presence in the Eucharist. He was taken aback at the reverence that they showed, and he's the priest through whom God performed the miracle of transubstantiation, or making Jesus present in the host. They fell to their faces in honor, knowing that Jesus was there. Mother Teresa said, "The time you spend with Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament is the best time that you will spend on earth, because he's present," and she knew it. And St. John Paul II also shared, "United with the angels and saints of the heavenly church, let us adore the most holy sacrament of Eucharist. Prostrate, we adore this great mystery." Again, another great saint saying, in absolute humble submission, we prostrate ourselves before Jesus present in the Eucharist. Question number two. How did so many saints live on the Eucharist? They really did. And I'm going to start with Mother Teresa shared, "Through Holy Communion, we live on the flesh of our Lord. And as we read in Scripture, Jesus says, 'I am the bread of life. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has life in me.' He says, 'I am.' Jesus is present. And when we consume, when we eat his flesh and drink his blood, we have life in us, his life." So four of the saints I want to talk about tonight are Alexandrina Maria, Teresa Newman, and servant of God, Luisa Picaretta. All amazing saints who lived, some of them decades, on the Eucharist alone. Alexandrina Maria, she was born in Portugal in 1904. From 1942 until her death 13 years later, she lived only on the Eucharist. No other source of food sustained her other than Jesus' presence in the Holy Eucharist. Teresa Newman, she was born in 1898 in Germany. She bore the stigma. Does anybody know what the stigma is? It's where Jesus shares in his suffering by giving saints his thigh wounds from his passion and crucifixion. So saints like Padre Pio and St. Catherine of Siena, even St. Rose of Lima, she had the crown of thorns, the wounds from the crown. But they had... So she bore the stigmata. She had the wounds of Christ on her hands. I don't know if she had them on her side, but also in her feet. So she bled all the time with these exposed wounds. Furthermore, for 36 years, she was nourished only on the Holy Eucharist. And then when you read the stories, I mean, if you ever have time, read the lives of saints. It's absolutely amazing. It's not one person that said, "Yeah, I think she did." These are people who lived with her in and out for 36 years and saw and witnessed to the truth that she truly lived on nothing other than the Eucharist. And this is a servant of God, Luisa Picaretta. She's not a saint yet, but you know, she's in heaven, we believe, and we're waiting for the Catholic Church to finish up the canonization process to also affirm that she is, you know, recognized by the Church as a saint. At the age of 22, she suffered the pains of our Lord's Passion, too, also joining him in the stigmata. She ate no food for 64 years, subsisting only on the Eucharist as her nourishment. Again, there's tons of writing on her, too. You can read the lives of these saints and learn about it. It's real. How is this possible? And then question number three, how can we really believe that Jesus is present? Bible says it, and there are these really cool Eucharistic miracles that I'm going to talk about too. And the process to affirm that a miracle is indeed a miracle is really extensive within the Vatican. And so to talk about them, I can't wait to talk about them. It's amazing because the church went through a lot to prove to us and to the church that they are real. So we can sit back and say, it's true. It's really a miracle. The process is amazing. So question number three again. Jesus says in Scripture, I am the bread of life. Anyone who eats this bread will live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh. And the Jews murmur, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? I mean, seriously, it sounds kind of creepy, right? It sounds creepy now, and I bet back then they're going, this guy's telling me to eat his flesh. That doesn't sound right. And the Jews, they go, I don't get this. This doesn't sound right to me. But Jesus didn't budge. He replied, I tell you most solemnly, if you do not eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you will not have life in you. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. He then repeats, who eats my flesh and drinks my blood lives in me and I in him. And then he repeats it again. Do you think he was speaking figuratively? He said, most solemnly. His followers took his words literally. Many had followed him for months, even years. When they listened to the words of Jesus in John chapter 6, verses 60 through 71, they said, this is intolerable language. Who can handle it? I don't believe this. I can't take this. And honestly, wouldn't you, it would be hard to handle. It would be hard to comprehend and say, he's asking me to eat his flesh and drink his blood. And he's done some pretty neat things, but this is a little much. Jesus knew what they were saying. And he asked them, did you shake your faith? After this, many of them stopped following him. They left. Now, these guys had seen him turn water into wine, bring Lazarus back to life, cure the lepers, cure blind. They'd seen so many miracles. Calm the storm, right? They watched him calm a storm. And this was too much for them to handle. So if we think that we, as mere humans, have a hard time handling it, it's because we're human. These guys actually witnessed the miracles and they walked. So, and I'll touch upon this too. The ones that stayed had the gift of faith. And remember, faith is a gift. And we have to pray for it. And so the ones that didn't believe, they did not have the gift of faith and they walked. And literally, they saw him perform miracle after miracle after miracle and they still walked. But Jesus didn't say, wait, hold on, guys. Just kidding. I'm speaking figuratively. Because he could have if he was. But he wasn't. He didn't ask him to hold on. He let him walk. Just some of his closest friends. Jesus is present in the Eucharist. Body, blood, soul, and divinity. When you see the Eucharist, it is Jesus. In our minds, it's hard to comprehend, but it is true. And as I mentioned earlier, another way that our Lord helps to instill faith, to give us that gift of faith, is through miracles. And the only time our Lord tries to, or performs a miracle, or allows a saint to perform a miracle, or anybody who, through whom he chooses to give the grace to perform a miracle, it is to help instill faith. Miracles, anytime you hear about them, they help you to believe that he is God. And the Eucharistic miracles that we'll talk about, they also are gifts from God to help instill a gift of faith. So we too can embrace this really challenging truth. There are 140 Vatican-approved Eucharistic miracles. 140. And again, the process for a miracle to be proven as a miracle is extremely long. Sometimes it takes decades, even more. And so 140 miracles have been proven to be true in the church. The first one we're going to talk about is Lanciano, Italy. And that one is very near and dear to my heart because when I was grappling with the truth of Jesus is present in the Eucharist, this was the one. I heard it on relevant radio. And I was overwhelmed. I thought, why have I never heard of this? I'm 40 plus years old, and I've never heard of any of these miracles. And I heard about it. I went home. I looked it up. There's a whole bunch of information on the internet about the Eucharistic miracles. And this one is so amazing. They're all so amazing. But that was the one when I heard it. It became truth to me. The next one is Buenos Aires, and this one actually happened under our now Pope Francis. He was cardinal at the time in Buenos Aires, so it's kind of neat to make that tie. And there's another one in Fleet, Austria in 1310, and then another one in Rome that's documented, they say, around the 6th or 7th century. And this is the miracle at Lanciano, occurred in 750 AD. So at the moment of consecration, the priest who was performing the Mass, he was tormented with doubts. So again, you guys think that you're not normal for grappling with this truth. A priest who has abundant grace, through whom the Lord works to perform his miracles, he too was questioning whether our Lord could truly be present in the Eucharist. After consecration, the host had transformed into a piece of flesh, and the wine was changed into real blood. Right before his eyes. So in March 4th, 1971, so how much longer? I already know when you think about this. This occurred in 750 AD. And they are still working with these materials, the host and the blood, in 1971. Flesh decomposes, right? Not this. Again, affirming the miraculous nature of this event. So in 1971, a detailed summary of various studies carried on the relics found the flesh is truly fresh flesh. It's made of a striated muscle tissue of the myocardium, or the heart. It is truly blood. The color analysis proves this with absolute and irrefutable certainty. The flesh and blood are definitely those of a human being, and both belong to the same blood group, AB, or AB positive, which is the same as the man in the Shroud of Turin, and also of the blood group typical of men or people in the Middle East. A lot of coincidences. There were no traces of any salts or anything to preserve the flesh. It shouldn't have lasted. There was no mummification on it, but it did. And it is not decomposed in over 1,200 years. In 1976, the World Health Organization and the UN declared that science, aware of any limitations, is forced to give an impossibility of explaining this occurrence. They can't explain it. It's a miracle. The monstrance containing the sacred relics is still on display. You can go to Lanciano, Italy today and see them on display. This is the Eucharist, that's the flesh, and there's the blood. Isn't that cool? And it gets better. But wait, there's more. I sound like a good, but wait, there's more. And then the Eucharistic miracle in Buenos Aires in August 1996, under, at the time, Archbishop Jorge Bergoglio, which is our Pope Francis. So a priest in Buenos Aires found a discarded host. And so what they're supposed to do, if a priest finds a consecrated host, they're supposed to take it and put it in water and let it dissolve. Because it's very sacred. It's Jesus. So we have to treat it very, very carefully. So he placed it in a container of water and put it away in the tabernacle of the chapel. And 8 days later, he found that it had turned to a bloody mass, or a bloody substance. And there is an image of it. And you can see the reflection of it in the bottom. Cool. In October 5th, 1999, Cardinal Bergoglio sent a sample for analysis. The cardiologist and forensic pathologist determined that the analyzed substance was real flesh and real blood containing human DNA. The analyzed material is a fragment of the heart muscle found in the wall of the left ventricle closest to the valves. They also found that the heart was alive when the sample was taken. And the heart had been beaten severely above the chest. The heart of our Lord, right? And the lab reports from Buenos Aires were compared to Lanciano miracle, and this was amazing. So they took, and the person that did the analysis did not know that he was looking at, he didn't know what he was looking at. And what they found was the two lab reports must have originated from test samples obtained from the same person. Over 2,000 years difference, and it's the same flesh. And both revealed AB positive blood type. And they are all characteristic of a man who lived in the Middle East region. Isn't that cool? But wait, there's more. Austria, in the year of Grace 1310, a priest was celebrating Mass, and after consecration, he too was seized with doubt of the real presence of Jesus in the Eucharist. After consecrating the wine, he was seized with doubt, and the wine changed to blood and began to boil in the chalice and overflow it. And this one is neat. The woman at Mass, this is in Rome, they say around the 6th or 7th century, a woman who had prepared the bread, because in those days it was literally a loaf of bread, not like we have today. So she, with her own hands and her own flour and own yeast, she prepared, I guess it's unleavened bread, so there's no yeast. Anyway, she prepared the bread for Mass. And she was laughing. She just couldn't believe it. She sat there as she's watching the priest, the consecration, and she just couldn't believe that the bread that she just made could really be Jesus. When the priest finished praying, the bread prepared by the woman, it changed into flesh and blood. The woman repented, she knelt down to the ground, and she began weeping bitterly. Even today, part of the relic of the miracle is preserved in Annex in Germany at the local Benedictine monastery. So if you ever have a chance to go to Europe, there's some really cool stuff that you could see to further instill and affirm our faith in Jesus' true presence in the Eucharist. And the fourth question is, how is it that MS Word, my Android, my kids' iPhones, all know that Jesus is truly present in the Eucharist? Well, try it. You go on to your Microsoft Word app or on your phone, type in the word Eucharist and see what it does. All major deities are capitalized. All of them. Try it. God, Allah, Buddha, Muhammad, etc. All of them autocorrect to capitalize. So even our phones know that Jesus is present in the Eucharist. My last question is, if all of these people and all of these things and all of these miracles prove and have instilled faith that Jesus is present in the Eucharist, how is it that so many of us still don't? And I'll say it a couple times throughout this talk. Faith is a gift. And we have to pray for it. And if we know that God created us to know, love, and serve Him, to be happy with Him in heaven, He is going to give us every grace we need to get there. So I promise you, every prayer you pray in earnest to help draw you closer to Him, He will answer. Excuse me. I do have a personal testimony I'd like to share, because I too, as I mentioned earlier, I struggled with the truth of Jesus' presence in the Eucharist, and people kept saying, go to Eucharistic adoration, and I honestly didn't even know what it was at the time. And there were so many things I didn't know about my faith when I, in the last 15, 20 years, and I tried it. I thought, okay, I'll go sit, and it just seemed kind of awkward, and I just sat in the room, it was quiet, and there was the monstrance, and I found every time I went, I wanted to go back. And I couldn't explain it. And nothing profound happened. I mean, at least, and the way the Lord works, He's a gentleman. So He does work very subtly in our souls. So that was an affirming truth in the way He works. But I was drawn there. And my husband, he called me a chapel hopper because we didn't have adoration chapels, or we didn't have one at our parish. And so I would just learn all the codes for all the local chapels, and so wherever I went, I would just hop in, even for 5 minutes, just to say hello. But I still can't explain to you the feeling that I received when I went there, and then the feeling that I had that drew me back. It's not of this world, but it's so beautiful there, and it's so peaceful there. And my husband and I had, at the time, 4 children. I had worked outside the home until that point, And I liked working outside the home, and it was very rewarding. And but after a lot of prayer, we had agreed that I would no longer work outside the home. And I think even at that point, we agreed to homeschool, so it was a really radical change in plan for us. But again, we prayed a lot, and so we trusted God would make it all work. But it was easier for me at the time to send my children to daycare, because I didn't think I was very patient. I didn't think I was going to be a good mom, and so I figured they'd probably do a better job than me. And so on the last day, in like the 9th, or the, you know, the 29th day of the 9th month of my pregnancy, you know what I mean? It was just moments before I was about to give birth to Charlie, our 4th child. I just stopped at the Adoration Chapel on my way to work. And I just wept and wept and wept. And I just said, God, I'm so scared. I'm so afraid of messing these kids up that you gave me. I'm worried about not being a good mom. I was scared to death. And I just sat there. And I was on my knees and I had my head down, crying. And I heard interiorly, as I interviewed the Lord, I said, I can't do this. He said to me, he said, yes, you can. You can't do it, but with me, you can. And it affirmed such a valid truth in our faith. We can do nothing without God. The only thing we own is our sin. And from that moment on, I knew it was going to be fine. I didn't have to know what it was going to look like. All I had to know was that I can't do it, but God can, and he's God. And I walked out of the chapel with a renewed sense of peace and trust, and from that moment on, my husband and I gave the keys to God and just said, this is your home, this is your family, do through us and with us as you will. And it has changed both of our hearts so dramatically in so many ways. And then, as I mentioned, I heard that miracle at Waconia on the radio. And so, even though I was going to Adoration, there was still that question. I mean, honestly, guys, it looks like a piece of bread. And so I would go in a door, and what I was feeling in my heart, what was drawing me, I couldn't explain. But I wasn't sure. And I did pray, because there were so many people who you could just see they had that faith, they had that love. And then I heard about the miracle at Waconia. And I found online, and I wish I could think of a website. There's a website that has every single solitary one of the 140 documented Eucharistic miracles. There's one where there was a city, and I can't remember the name of the city, where somebody had thrown consecrated hosts into the river because it was during Christian persecution, and the fish grabbed them all and brought them up to the water to be retrieved. Isn't that cool? Anyway, so there are so many things out there that we can look into that can help and affirm the faith that we so desperately seek, that helps us bring the peace and helps us bring the trust in this, I'd say, pretty complex truth. So again, faith is a gift, and I just ask each of you to humbly entreat our Lord for that gift. Because, as I mentioned earlier, God created us for one reason. And if any of you remember the Baltimore Catechism, did anybody learn about the Baltimore Catechism when they were young? That's what I was taught out of. And it teaches God created us, as I said earlier, to know, love, and serve him so that we can be happy with him in heaven. And God will give us every single solitary piece of grace that we need to get there. He is that faithful. And so if you lay your heart out in front of our Lord, he will give you everything you need to help draw you closer to him, because that's why you're here. And that's why, and I'm sure most of you are children in the program, he gave your children to you to help get them to heaven. And so you are very important to him on so many levels, because not only is it your soul that he's invested in completely, whom he's relentlessly pursuing all the time to draw you closer to him, he's also entrusted you with children. And those souls are also called to be with him forever, because he created them to know, love, and serve him, so they too could be happy with him in heaven. So, I'm going to review the five questions one more time. Why do the saints fall prostrate in the presence of the Eucharist? Because he's present. Mother Teresa, St. John Paul II, many of the great saints. How many saints, or how did how is that so many great saints lived on the Eucharist alone? Jesus says, I am the bread of life. As he says to the woman at the well, the flesh that you have does not preserve life, the flesh that I have.